finally are formed gracious way of life. And is the broad the crop most peculiarly and which earliest set found the Indian bay pipes, the aromatic annual called tobacco. Well down and westward into Missouri and is divided into three major regions. This is the so-called Bright Vineyard, the Carolinas, Georgia, and Florida. Tobacco types are determined by different soil, rainfall, and temperature. Type most widely grown and using the largest annual income is called bright tobacco, so named color of its cured leaf. Bright tobacco is heat-treated on racks in a curing barn. This process gives it a mildness and flavor that provides the base for a wide range of different smoking blends. From Maryland comes another major strain of tobacco grown in just five counties of the state. In blending, it serves a double purpose. It has a flavor found in no other tobacco, and it burns more freely. Missouri, Kentucky, Tennessee, and Ohio grow the third major strain of tobacco, Burly, famous the world over for its fine smoking qualities. The Burly leaf is more like Maryland than bright, and, like Maryland, is cured simply by hanging it in well-ventilated barns. Prized for the spice it imparts to the blend is the highly aromatic small-leafed strain of tobacco known as Turkish. Millions of pounds of Turkish are imported for Chesterfield from the Near East every year. Grown primarily for its seed. The flax fiber is brought by train loads to be processed in Acosta's new streamlined paper mill. Mixed with pure cold mountain water, the flax is shredded and pounded to a creamy pulp. It is passed through mixers and condensers until it is ready to be a fine meshed screen, where the water is drawn off and the pulp passed on to be formed into cigarette paper, miles and miles of it. The leaves must have their moisture content adjusted to a uniform level, so the racks are passed into a chamber where an exact amount of moisture of finest Western fir. Into it is pressed about half a ton of grated leaf, bright, burly, or Maryland. On the outskirts of Durham, Liggett and Meyer's vast warehouses stretch out like a city within a city. Endless is the parade of trucks bringing hogsheads of tobacco to be aged. In the warehouses, the hogsheads are stacked up according to an elaborate plan of rotation, and on each is fastened a pedigree of the tobacco that it contains, where it was grown, what type it is, and when it was bought. For many to understand tobacco as a business and as a way of life, one must enter a home which tobacco was built, and where an entire family's life moves with the growth cycle of the crop. Of the many farmers in tobacco land, Claude Whitehead of Chatham, Virginia, is one of the most progressive. The tobacco cycle begins in January, and plans for the year's operations absorb the interest of the whole Whitehead family. Winter is waning, and the time has come to get ready the tobacco seed bed. Tobacco seed is almost microscopic, about the size of the poppy seeds you get on bakery rolls. The farmer mixes the seed with neutral soil to ensure an even distribution in the sowing. His seed has been selected after many years of experimentation and improvement, not only by the planter, but by government agencies. The three great types of American tobacco, Maryland, Burly, and Bright, were each developed regionally by natural factors, but variations within each type have been scientifically adapted to help the farmer get the best and the most abundant yield from his particular acreage. While the seeds are germinating, there will be plenty of time for many small spring chores around the farm. It is a great day for the farmer when the seed bed's protective covering can be drawn back to inspect the first leaflets of this New Year's tobacco crop. But before the seedlings can be transplanted to the fields, many more warm and sunny days must pass. Trees flower, all of Tobaccoland's farmers prepare their fields to receive the tobacco seedlings. A farmer usually drives his own tractor to plow his own acres, for, like all farmers, the tobacco planter loves the soil. Then, too, tobacco is a crop requiring infinite pains. Farmers like to say that it takes 13 months a year to raise good tobacco, months of planning and preparation, months of careful attention to the growing crop. Dawn of the first transplanting day comes as a zero hour for the tobacco farmer. He will be up with the sun and will breakfast heartily, for before nightfall, tens of thousands of his tobacco seedlings must be taken from the seed bed and set out to grow. At stake in this operation will be Farmer Whitehead's biggest cash crop and the bulk of his income for the year ahead. All hands are needed in the fields and at the seed beds on this day to lift the baby plants gently out of the earth and carry them to the planting fields. To set out his tobacco seedlings precisely and individually in neat rows and at exact intervals, Farmer uses an ingenious device which, although slower than automatic transplanters, enables him to see that every one of his plants is healthy and gets a proper start in life. On this day, or on days near it, the entire Southland will be stitched across with a delicate green petty point. Now, a prayer for rain. Tens of thousands of thirsty shoots need water. Again, the Southland's mountain ranges come to the aid of the farmer in lifting the damp winds from the sea to be cooled and condensed into the blessing of rain. More spring days pass. The critical period is over. Tobacco seedlings have struck root and are growing sturdily. Until they get too tall, they can be cultivated by power machinery, carefully steered along the contoured rows. The earth must not be allowed to harden and cake around the young roots. Weeds must be discouraged, and for this work, there is no labor-saving substitute for the good old-fashioned hoe. Even in a mechanical age, no one who wrests a good life from the soil can avoid diligent work, nor would they want to. While the men are busy with tobacco, Mother Whitehead has some rows of her own to hoe. Like everything else about the Whitehead farm, Mrs. Whitehead's department is thoroughly equipped to make the most of nature's bounty. Time was when folks only canned their vegetables or laid them away to dry. Mrs. Whitehead can take her vegetables garden fresh and deep freeze them so that the Whiteheads can enjoy fresh vegetables all next winter. Farm life need not be as tiresome as it used to be. A farmer's lady need not be a drudge. Between household chores, there is time for many more pleasant things. Time for gracious living, time for a flower garden, time for the problems of the young. Thank you. Like many of the ladies in Tobaccoland, Mrs. Whitehead takes proper pride in her grounds and planting. And this year, her garden club holds its midsummer show at her home. And for the young, vacation is not all hoeing and weeding. Meanwhile, the southern sun shines, the tobacco leaves fill out, and the summer is a long, lazy growing time. Frequently, the county agent comes by to check with Farmer Whitehead on the progress of his tobacco crop. The plants are strong and healthy. How many pounds does it look like to the acre? Because of their years of experience, Farmer Whitehead and the agent can quite accurately answer that question far ahead of picking time. Granted, of course, normal weather for the remainder of the growing season. Another turning point in the tobacco cycle comes when the stalk is ready to blossom into a white flower, which, if allowed to bloom, would make Tobaccoland even more picturesque. But instead, the budding stalk is broken off to direct the plant's full strength into growing richer and more luxuriant leaves. This operation is called topping, and each single plant of Mr. Whitehead's many thousands must be dealt with individually. While the top tobacco is getting its final growth, there is time to harvest other crops. For the tobacco farmer of today, however prosperous, is not a one-crop operator. Wheat he may raise, and other grains. For the livestock will be a crop of hay, not just stacked up, but properly baled. Mr. Whitehead's hay crop includes some fine alfalfa. Dairy products form a considerable portion of Tobaccoland's output. Though tobacco yields